Hello and welcome to the launch of issue 5 of Bloomers magazine titled Where We Once Lived, Where Myths Collided. And in a minute, I'm going to introduce Kim Crowley, our editor, who conceptualised the issue, who's going to talk a little bit more about it and the ideas that inspired it. But first, I'm just going to introduce Bloomers for anyone that mightn't know.
Bloomers is an independent, multi-channel arts organisation dedicated to the discussion and support of emerging female artists based in Ireland online, through events, and via our biannually printed publication, Bloomers Magazine. Bloomers Magazine is a curated selection of visual art and text which examines specific themes per issue. And for the last 2 years, we have released this biannually produced publication, which has actually featured over 60 artists and writers who identify as emerging female artists based in Ireland. Our aim is to discuss and support emerging female artists based in Ireland in a number of ways that provide a platform that allow a wider audience to learn about their work and provide a space where they can learn about one another. Recently, we embarked on a research project to assess the needs of emerging female artists based in Ireland to make additional efforts to mould our project into a professional development tool to understand what they need, what their experiences are, and how these needs can be met and how these experiences can be improved and what we as an organisation can do.
We tend to hold launch events to bring people together to celebrate the release of a new issue. And these typically take the form of discussion events where we would invite a number of the artists and writers involved in the issue to come and discuss their research practice, the work that they featured and what inspires them. So the launch for this issue was originally meant to be held in the Lecture Theatre of Crawford Art Gallery in Cork, following the success of a launch event that we held there last November for issue 4 of Bloomers titled Out of Body. Due to the current lockdown measures, we were unable to go ahead with the launch, so instead we decided to make the launch happen online so that people could gather and be inspired by the work of this group of really talented emerging artists and writers from the safety of their own home.
Hello, I'm Kim Crowley and I'm editor of issue 5 of Bloomers, Where We Once Lived, When Myths Collided, and thank you so much for coming to the launch. So the title for this issue comes from a poem, Love, by Eavan Boland. And of course, we were given the sad news a few months back that Eavan Boland actually died at the age of 75 this year. But before all that, I had chosen this poem as a kind of grounding text for the issue, which I was interested in looking at myth and how myth influences our society today. And this poem by Eavan Boland, she mythologizes her feelings of love and emotion and maybe feelings that she can't quite express herself, and she correlates this with this myth of going into the underworld. So up on the slide there you can see the first verse of the poem. So dark falls on this Midwestern town where we once lived when myths collided. Dusk has hidden the bridge in the river, which slides and deepens to become the water, the hero crossed on his way to hell. Back in April we heard the sad news of Eavan's death, and she was one of the most prominent voices in Irish literature, and her passing was a shock to the writing community and beyond. But before any of this had happened, I had chosen this poem, Love, as a grounding text for the issue. In this poem, Eavan connects her personal emotions and feelings to the mythical, and she kind of does this transformation of the everyday and paralleling ordinary life with the mythological throughout her poems. I was listening to the Irish Times podcast with Ness O'Mahony, and she says how Eavan uses mythology in her poetry and takes it back from the male pantheon. So she writes about women and the ordinary person that is maybe often left outside of history, and she is restoring their position within history. So this brings me on to the next slide, which has a quote by Eavan Boland from her book Object Lessons, where she discusses how women are represented in mythology. The heroine as such was utterly passive. She was Ireland or Hibernia. She was stamped as a rubbed away mark on silver or gold, a compromised regal figure on a throne, or she was a 19th century image of girlhood on a frontispiece or in a book of engravings. She was invoked, addressed, remembered, loved, regretted, and most important, died for. She was a mother or a virgin, and she had no speaking part. If her harvest were spoiled, her mother tongue wiped out, her children killed, then it was for someone else to mark the reality. Her identity was an image. So I think this is really interesting because it really shows what kind of like a passive figure the female was in mythology, both in Ireland and also in other mythology. In the next slide, I have some images of how Ireland has been personified as a kind of young woman. From the late 1600s up to the late 1700s, there was a genre of poetry called Aisling poetry, where it depicted Ireland as this young maiden awaiting, saving, and lamenting the plight of the Irish people. So she became like a symbol of what Ireland was. And then, even in the early 1900s, 20th century, they looked back at this poetry and they reimagined Ireland as figures that we would be kind of more au fait with, like Roisin Dubh or Kathleen Houlihan. So this brings me on to looking at what the main overall themes were for this issue starting off. So we wanted the work to offer us ways and points of departure to contemplate and look at how myth has impacted on contemporary society and how it manifests, how these narratives are used as sources of either education, entertainment, and also, more interestingly, I think anyway, a way for preserving culture and also instilling values and morals. So we wanted the issue to question, explore these narratives, make us question where these narratives came from, who's represented in them, paralleling the lines between idealism and reality, and exploring multiple layers of history that are embedded within these stories. The first artist that I want to discuss today that features in the issue is Gemma Kearney, and we chose her piece, The Construction of Meaning, to feature in the issue. Gemma is a sculptor, and she looks at social narratives, personal events, looks at culture and society, and this piece, The Construction of Meaning, takes the idea of a relic and kind of in an absurd way shows us how we put meaning into these objects. So the work both playfully challenges and champions the dichotomy of belief ideologies through iconographic tokenism, viewing belief systems as the mechanisms that equip us with the means to navigate life. The work looks at what happens when opposing ideologies meet and asks if it is possible for radical or dissenting voices to exist and impact on already established and often dogmatic constructs. She's primarily a sculptor, but she also works in painting, print, multimedia. And her work looks at historical events, personal narratives, personal events, and kind of collides them. The next artist that we feature in the issue is Rosie Kennedy and her beautiful painting Orange Green and All in Between. Overall, her work looks at the rural landscape, looks at storytelling, folklore, the spoken word, and she also looks at culture, time, value, and this painting is basically an idea of a parade. And I'll just read you the text from Rosie's artist statement, which really encapsulates what the painting's about. It's based on the idea that an annual set day or festival took place in June and featured a parade made up of many different parties of people, each carrying handmade effigies on poles and making their way down through the hills for music and dancing in the valley below. Every group was competing for the best dressed effigy, and during the parade, opponents slandered one another's creative work using humorous verse. It looks at the idea of an effigy as an extension of individual taste or values. The next artist that we featured is Rachel Clark and her painting Dryan, which means blackthorn in English. And the blackthorn was a wildflower, it would be considered the sister plant to the hawthorn tree. So they'd both be considered fairy trees in Irish folklore. It would have more sinister connotations in Celtic tree lore, where it would be used to represent death or warfare or the coilach. But it's also quite seen as a protective tree with healing powers and symbolising the cycle of life. So the next artist in the new issue is Isabella Szkokowska, and we featured her series Seer, which was in collaboration with Eilish Collins, and it's based on looking at females' role and voice within Irish myth and how it's represented. And we also use an image of Isabella's for the front cover. The final artist that we included in this issue 5 is Lynn Marie Denny, and Sarah Long has written a response to her work in the issue, and I'll just read a bit there about Lynn's work. So she views Greek and Roman sculpture and architecture as appropriated symbols of institutional authority, and she investigates ways of looking at history that neutralise the agendas and strategies of the institution, leaving a space for new ideas and perspectives that exist independent of politics and power relations. And the image on screen there is from her piece of work entitled Problems of Frailty. So that was a brief look at the artists that we've included in issue 5, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the launch. Thanks so much to all the artists who were involved in issue 5, who made all possible, and to the whole team of Bloomers, and to Diane Deere, especially for her fantastic design, as always. So thank you so much for coming to the launch.
Hi guys, I'm Sarah Divney, and I'll be discussing a bundle of silent tantrums in this issue of Bloomers. So taking from the story Aeneid, which the title of the issue is taken from, I looked upon narrative as a pivotal point of the work. A female narrative which takes a local and global position but exhibited within a mythical context. It was also an aim of further writing for the foreground of one narrative to take a background in another, which is evident in the conclusion which takes place in the first narrative. I feel this conclusion creates a more emotive experience to mortality and to the relationship between women and Irish culture. It also evolves to remove the single he from the narrative to create a contemporary feminist union as one she passes knowledge down to the younger sister. So I begin with Gemma Kearney's work. The construction of meaning, from which I took the idea of the relic and Irish nature to rely on myth, as well as the normality of worship in Irish culture. I access this through an inner narrative of consciousness, which is positioned in a relatable and accessible Irish dialect. It is a mix of story and report, with myth and fact coming together to exist in a incontestable context, more so. From this I came to Rachel Clark's work, whereby the saturation of the colours created an atmosphere from which I could introduce the initial she. It is worth noting during this work that there is only one he, but various forms of she, which makes more sense in the reading than it does me talking about it. But this really allows an influential female to be introduced, but not as a singular, but to be extended as far as Mother Nature, your mother, and to the I. This narrative takes us then through the ceremonious work of Rosie Kennedy, where I allow the material used in other works to presented in issue 5 to influence the transformation of the Irish landscape. Through the pageantry of Irish ritual and religious celebrations, it is an idea ingrained in Irish culture, and is a special understanding of silence, its rogue nature on the verge of release. The mythical aspect of the writing allows objects and the landscape to become animated and withhold hidden properties to reveal hidden rituals. Responding to Eilish and Isabella's collaborative work, it was mainly an accumulation of the narrative thus far. As I said before, it is positioned in the first narrative and also situates the work in County Cork relative to the Blarney Stone, which is where the blessing of eloquence and persuasiveness is introduced. It is within this collaboration which I feel the emotive narrative presented itself to me and suits the first narrative greatly as a conclusion to the writing. The work is largely inspired by Dan Decca Chapman in relation to storytelling and Vivian Chopchak's insight to autofictional and autobiographical performative writing. Overall I find that it was a different form of response to a series of artworks, and it was a great experience to not just do a regular art review and to have it more experimental in that form, which I find is very pivotal to Bloomers and to what they're trying to get across. So thanks guys and stay safe.
My epistema, it's epistemic here from Swansea in Wales, and I'm really excited and chuffed to be part of the fifth issue of Bloomers with an essay I've written in both Welsh and English on medieval Welsh mythology, and rereading this mythology from a feminist perspective. I originally wrote the essay in Welsh a couple of years ago, studying Welsh and philosophy in Cardiff University, and I translated the essay for Bloomers, which was a really great experience, because usually translation can be quite a clinical, robotic process, so it was great to be able to translate something creatively for this magazine. And I guess this was the first essay I've ever written that made me think about how essay writing isn't just about living in a world of academia or trying to impress intellectually. It can be about activism, and essay writing can actually be a way of trying to draw attention to issues within our society and challenge those issues. So calling out sexism in these really highly regarded myths and legends from the Mabinogi and the legend of Dewi Sant, this was a really empowering thing for me to do, because it made me feel like I was in charge of my own history, rather than just being an onlooker and feeling powerless to changing the narrative of that history. So I hope writing this essay is a little gesture of trying to change that and to take charge of this. So I'll read you a little bit of the Welsh version first of all, just for you to hear the language. And to hear the names and things in the essay, so money. Wrth adansoddi chwedlau blodeiwedd a bychef ddewi yn fanol, yr enghreifftiau sy'n galw am feirniadau ffemynyddol weithiau yn boenus o amlwg. Bryd arall, anodd yw datgyddio'r rhagfarn a mae rhan naturiol o strwythyr hanes y Duw, ac rydym ninnau wedi'n cyflwyru'n gymdeithasol i dderbyn y rhywiaeth hwn fel rhan anatod o fframwaith yn ein hymwneud â'n gilydd. Fel y nododd Delyth George, i gynheiliad y drefn hon, mae'r pygynnu a'r stereodeipio yn ddatblygiad naturiol, yn gynrychioladol o reddfau cynhenid y ddau ryw, ac nid yn rhywbeth a impiwyd ar gymdeithas gan ddymuniad un rhyw i ornesu y llall. So that section just talks briefly about how we are trained to think that sexism is an inherent part of human nature. A natural phenomenon rather than something that's been constructed by society and by patriarchy. So I guess this essay is trying to break down those notions that these things are inherent in our culture, or unnatural So the process of translating into English was interesting in that this mythology, the Mabinogi in Wales, is so well known to most Welsh people. It's sort of part of our identity, and or at least if we know about it, and sort of there's a lot of cultural baggage that goes with it. So in translating, it's near impossible to try and convey that worldview within a translation, because it's so attached to the Welsh language. And things like the names of the characters, so like Blodeuwedd is who I talk about in the first part of the essay, and her name can't really be translated. It's one of those words that is part of the narrative of the story and is so interwoven with it that it's hard to translate. But if you were to translate it literally, it would mean flower face. So there's a lot of shortcomings when it comes to translations. I kept the names the same and did my best to try and convey this worldview best I could. And then it was striking for me to look at the legend of our patron saint, Dewi Sant, who is held in high esteem in Wales. We sort of grow up to worship him as children. We sing songs about him, like probably happens in Ireland with Patrick. He can do no wrong. And so reading about the legend of his life from a feminist perspective is quite kind of ruined my childhood in a way, because it sort of broke down all those ideas of his all these naive notions of this saintly character and the wonder of his lifetime. So I'll read some of that passage for you now about how Dewi Sant, St. David, was brought into the world. After we learn that it was through the process of raping Non that St. David comes to the world, it is more difficult for the modern reader to believe the naive spiritual myth-making that is presented to us from childhood, that purity endured in every element of the life of our patron saint. However, it is only through assessing the details very carefully that we begin to understand the extent of the truly awful connotations associated with this act of rape. If the fact that the most extreme way of oppressing a woman leads to the birth of a saint is not enough to make a woman know her status within society, the situation is rendered even more disturbing by the name of the rapist, the King Sant. There is no mention of the hellish irony of this image. And in contrast to how the handmaidens are described, there is no reference to the king as a bad man. Indeed, is there not a disgusting implication in his name and in the results of his actions that this is some sort of holy attack? The terrorizing violation is narrated without emotion, with no concern for none. It is almost as if there is a perverse hope in its telling, as Dewi's birth clouds the violence of his conception. So it's a really dark telling of the story, and I think it's really important for us to look back to history and reread these stories and pick out what is problematic about them, and because those elements are carried forward through history, and those ideas, those ways of treating each other are reinforced and repeated through upholding these stories and seeing them as untouchable. So if we can begin to challenge and to analyse what's going on in these stories, I think we can sort of try and change society now. And in terms of my own work now, I'm studying a master's in drawing at Glasgow School of Art, and I've carried forward a lot of the ideas that I had studying Welsh philosophy. And I guess the genre of the essay is really interesting in that you can say a lot through an essay, and you can you can really dig deep into a subject area. So I'm hoping to try and think of ways of reaching a wider audience through the essay as an art form, and through performance and sharing and discussion of these issues, because not everybody likes to read long essays, but I'm desperate to sort of share and disseminate these ideas, and we really need to analyse and scrutinise things now, I think. So going forward, I'm hoping to try and think of the essay and how it can be shared in different creative ways. Thank you very much to Bloomers for letting me be the token Welshie in this issue. I'm really excited to be working with this Irish magazine that's doing such great work, and hope that this can be a window to start working together more and more, because stuff like Brexit and the coronavirus and British imperialism really scary at the minute. So hopefully through sharing our creative output across borders, we can get some solidarity and some hopeful vision for the future. So diolch yn fawr a cariad mawr. Thank you.
Hi everyone, thanks so much for tuning in. My name is Sarah, and I'm going to be doing a reading of the text I wrote for this issue of Bloomers. First, I'll just introduce myself, and then I'll introduce the text. So I'm a visual artist and writer. I'm a graduate of Crawford College, and in September I'll be doing an MLit in art writing in Glasgow School of Art. So my practice is largely concerned with the landscape as a receptacle of human ideas. A place where nature and allegory are intrinsically intertwined. So naturally, mythology plays a role in my work. I had my first solo show in September in Studio 12 in the Backwater Artist Group. It was called Kingdom, and it was dealing with cultural memory and the Irish landscape through the use of painting and sculpture and text. At the minute, although it is closed, obviously, I have a show in the Sternview Gallery called A Place Where I Thought Might Grow, and it's a series of paintings that are in part responding to Greek mythology. For this issue, I'm responding to the work of Lynn Marie Dennehy, Lynn's wonderful work. It's very powerful. It's concerned with the relationship between Greek mythology and power systems, and the politicising of Greek and Roman sculpture. And you can see the influence of Foucault in her work, in how successful it is at getting you to question power systems that appropriate Greek mythology to consolidate their power. And what I think is really interesting is, because of the way the world is today and because of who's in power, there's a lot more questioning of power and systems and narratives going on, I think. And that's what I wanted this piece to respond to, was this atmosphere, this kind of vague feeling that some shadowy figure is pulling the strings. I was kind of thinking of, you know, nameless faceless men, or what Allen Ginsberg called the six billionaires running America, that kind of idea. So I took that feeling and combined it with the suggestion in Lynn's work that the control that Greek mythology exerts over us, it's a very everyday thing. So I took those two things and I ended up with the figure of the raven. And the raven is obviously steeped in Greek mythology, but I was thinking of it as an everyday occurrence, I guess. But also I was thinking of Hitchcock and Daphne du Maurier, the birds, and how they attack, and we don't have an explanation for this. And I was thinking of what we do as humans, and we don't have an explanation for something. Historically, we would have created myths, but today we create conspiracy theories, and I think it's quite interesting, this this want to put order, I suppose, on chaos. I was also referencing Edgar Allan Poe's The Raven, touching off the idea of an unreliable narrator, but also because it's thought that he's referencing a form of Greek storytelling with that poem. So I think that's enough of an introduction. White marble, black feathers, world order. Perched and sat and nothing more, the whole world, under my wing. They think my morning song is soothing. It is a triumph, I own you. Beware of Greeks bearing gifts. I shit down upon them and they call it luck. I rode it on Apollo's shoulder. I forget how the story goes, but I'm here now. It is carved in stone somewhere. We came from stone, Gaia. And if you're lucky, you are immortalized in stone. That is how you get to shape history, to form. Form creates content. Stories don't exist without the telling of them. Form, entesis. The column decreases as it moves upward. Up where I watch your unhappy childhoods. Your tragic youths. Where you lie on the curve of my wingspan. You have a duty to tell me where you are going. I only have eyes for you. I watch. I notice. I observe. I study. I govern. I measure. I know. Up where I watch. Up, 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 up. White high. I am standing on history, or the shoulders of giants, or some other apothegm. I am Greek glory. This column pushes down onto the earth. I know, 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 I know. As my power has waxed, yours waned. As my power has waxed, yours waned.
Hi guys, I'm Lynn Marie Dennehy. I just want to start by thanking all the gang of Bloomers, because I'll forget at the end. This is such a weird way of giving a talk, so you'll have to excuse me if I'm constantly looking down at my notes. So my practice is very much research based, and so I decided that that's what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about some of my research to give you a kind of an idea of the journey that my research went on to get to the point that it is at today. So I'm going to talk to you about museums, I'm going to talk to you about the Grand Tour, I'm going to talk to you about the French Revolution, I'm going to talk about the Enlightenment, but first I'm going to talk about Star Trek. So whenever Captain Kirk lands on a planet with a lost civilization, we're generally met with this kind of picture of ancient Greece. Broken statues, ruined temples, and these big imposing white marble columns that dominate the alien landscape. There's normally blue sand because it's an alien planet. But the set kind of tells a story of a people at the pinnacle of civilization, a people of music, of poetry, of philosophy. It's generally a landscape full of the symbolism of ancient Earth. We get it immediately, that's the thing. We know these people. We are these people, you know. Normally the episode ends with some ridiculous alien masquerading as Apollo and threatening the Enterprise, but that's not really important. So the point is that we see these bare white columns, the pristine marble statues, and we're automatically drawn into a narrative of a great civilization. So my research tries to kind of draw attention to how easily history can be manipulated and how casually we can be drawn into a fiction. And I do this by playing with the idea of museums. So museums are, they're like microcosms, like tiny worlds within worlds intended to reflect the entirety of our history back to us, or the entirety of our culture back at us. their repositories, the repositories of the collective knowledge of all of humanity. They're, but importantly, they're institutions whose authority seems unquestionable. But they're not neutral spaces where we can encounter an untarnished representation of the past. They're contested spaces, and they have a power to frame how we view history. It gets kind of a little bit researchy here. So the idea is that they kind of exist within society in a kind of an isolation or a quarantine that's separate from what's going on outside. And they're this single site that contain infinite histories, stories, times, mythologies, spaces. And they function differently at different points in history. And that's normally dictated by whatever culture they're attached to. A good example of this is the Louvre in Paris. So that was originally the kind of the brainchild or the idea of Louis XVI. And the whole idea behind it was to create this museum of treasures that would demonstrate to the world the supremacy of French art and, by proxy, the supremacy of France and its monarch. But what happened was the French Revolution, and the revolutionaries took this idea of the museum and appropriated it, and the new regime used it to kind of legitimize the revolution, kind of as a way of influencing and reinforcing its the new national identity of France. So it acted as this instrument of education. So it gave the citizens access to the ousted monarch's treasures. So it showed the strength of the new regime and created, and they used the art then to create new mythologies that would reinforce the new nation's place in a kind of a grander history. So I suppose what it means is like museums set a narrative. So throughout my research, this idea of this kind of idea of being able to control a narrative has become an increasing obsession, I suppose, like an obsession with ideas of truths. So how truths are formed, who establishes what is true, and how truth can be concealed or revealed. When considering classical architecture and art, you can see it from different points of time, different time periods in history, and each point will tell you something new about whatever objects or displays they have going on. So a lot of my research was about museums and how they came into existence, and that led me on to doing a lot of research about the Grand Tour. Now the Grand Tour was it's really strange doing it this way. The Grand Tour was a custom of the late 16th century and onwards to about the early 19th century, where English gentlemen of privilege, they would finish their education by going on this grand tour, this educational trip that would take about 2 to 3 years. And they would visit the cultural and historic places of Europe. So they were expected to gain an understanding of art and architecture by exposure to the great masterpieces and historic cultural places. So they would visit Paris, Venice, Florence, all those kinds of big European cities. But the most important destination was Rome, because Rome was where the treasures were. And since there was no museums at the time, especially in Europe, these gentlemen would use their privilege to gain access to private collections and excavation sites of the ancient world. And their time was well spent. They spent a lot of their time acquiring souvenirs in the form of art, sculpture, and maybe some Elgin marbles. So many of these collections of souvenirs went on to form the basis of modern day museums. The other thing is that the Grand Tour took place in the time of the Enlightenment, where things like logic and rationality were kind of the guiding parameters of thought. the logical, symmetrical structure of ancient monuments and temples were kind of almost a physical embodiment of this approach to thinking. So these young men sent out on the grand tour, returned and began to emulate the Greeks, attempting to recreate the kind of the nobility and the grandeur of a great civilization. And they did this by building like follies in the garden of ancient temples, and this kind of eventually transferred into culture and became neoclassical architecture. And these neoclassical buildings became a way of promoting a sense of power and authority that they thought reflected the power and authority of Greece. And it helped create a cultural hegemony where the ruling classes could manipulate the culture of a society so that their worldview became the accepted worldview. So I am going to end the history lesson at some point, but first I'm going to give you an example of one grand tourist and how he influenced my work. So his name was Henry Blundell. He went on the grand tour a little bit later in life, so he was a little bit older than most of the guys who would have gone over. So it was in around the 18th century. And he amassed a vast collection of Roman and Greek antiquities. And like many of his contemporaries, when he returned, he started to emulate them. He built a temple in his back garden, which I'm sure was huge. But what he also did was he restored a lot of his acquisitions. He brought home bits of sculptures and like grafted Roman arms onto Greek sculptures and kind of imposed a kind of an 18th century and 19th century aesthetic and morality onto these ancient sculptures and architecture. He would do things like sand off all the colour, the original colour from the statues, because what was attractive at the time was that it was the pure, austere white marble This is very strange. So these were no longer Greek statues. They were no longer Roman copies of Greek statues. They were 18th century artifacts. They were part of the 18th century now. I'm going to give you a little quote from a letter that Henry Blundell wrote to one of his friends, which I think is kind of a real illustration of this. My Diana is also a fine specimen of ancient sculpture all over. The parts are almost all its own, except the face, which was found so much disfigured as to require a new mask. So he just built a new face for this sculpture, like completely from his own imagination or the sculptor's imagination. And it's this kind of bastardizing of history and all its implications that can be filtered into one object that fascinated me. This idea that you could take something from 2000 years ago and just turn it into some sort of Frankenstein's monster of history. And it's this that really influenced my work. So I'm going to talk about the work from Problems of Frailty, because I think this was the first kind of eureka moment in my research, and how the research and the practice connected. It's kind of like a lodestone for my practice. Whenever I get a little bit kind of, what the hell am I doing? I go back to that. So process is really important in my practice. I work mainly in printmaking and sculpture. I have a few elements of performance and video in there as well, but it's mainly sculpture and printmaking. And I like to try and link the two. I like to kind of play with the boundaries there, because I think they're very similar processes in terms of creating a matrix and taking patterns and taking replicas and things like that. And it's very important for me for the process of the work to be very visible to the viewer. And I like to leave clues about the process in the work, and I like to reference different processes and different pieces. So if I'm making a piece of sculpture, I might reference some of my prints that are in the same kind of assemblage or the same kind of space. So I started using images of Greek and Roman architecture and sculpture as this kind of way of representing the institution, like the museum or whatever institution, but the trick was to kind of build in as many contradictions as I could into each object, and to at the same time kind of cram each object with information, so that it's almost like that kind of bastardized sculpture where there's so much history and so much stuff in it, but it's still
the same image. So I use the example of Star Trek at the start, one because I'm a Trekkie and I like to talk about Star Trek, and the other is because a lot of my work mimics the idea of a set or a stage. It's only a facade. I use the imagery to create these cardboard cutouts with like crudely printed images that are just, they're just A4 paper printed out and stuck on and supported by kind of these wooden frames that are very exposed. And I'm just going to kind of go through some of the little things that I add to them, or that I think I add to them. That's this idea of adding in contradictions and information. So they can be assembled, disassembled, and reassembled again in another space. So their context is quite fluid. And it changes wherever I set them up. Like they're in my bedroom now. And, you know. So the original images that I use are screen grabs from Google Images. They're just these tiny little images that get blown up to the approximate size of the original sculptures. So they become pixelated, they become blurred, they become kind of distorted through the process of kind of digital manipulation. And then they're sliced up into A4 sheets and they're put back together again with sellotape. So that's again, I'm manipulating them again. And then of course there's the 2D nature of them. The 2D I really love, because as you walk around these sculptures in space, their perspective warps and you kind of get a different view of them, and you walk around and it's just these exposed frames just and sellotaped onto the, well, not sellotaped, but duct taped onto the back of them. Sometimes I print them in kind of stereoscopic 3D, and I provide 3D glasses to view them, and that kind of plays with this idea of 2D, 3D again, because they started off as these 3D images and then are 3D sculptures, sorry, and then they became images on the internet, and then they were taken off that and turned back into these 3D objects, but they're still 2D, and it's a whole thing. So the frames then, the wooden frames, are partly painted in cyan, magenta, yellow and black, and this is again just a reference to the prints I make that kind of go with these objects, so they're kind of talking to each other. Other little things would be, I chose the image of Hercules because this is an image that's used a lot in etchings and engravings that you'd see of the French Revolution. Hercules was seen as the protector of the people. So you would see these scenes of guillotine beheadings, and in the corner there'd be just like a little Hercules with his club over his shoulder. What else? In some of them I would Photoshop on like separate legs or different arms, and that's just my little nod to Henry Blundell. And then there's the titles. I like to kind of play with titles in my work. Sometimes they're very pretentious, like these ones. But for these ones, I was very specific. So titles like The Farnese Hercules, which is this guy. So the original title of this is Farnese Hercules, 4th century BC. But I always call it Farnese Hercules, 4th century BC, later Irish copy. And then this guy is, or this girl, sorry, is the 21st copy of a lost Greek original. So I'm trying to place them in the present. So I'm kind of playing with their kind of temporal status, as it were. And so these works, they exist alongside other works. So it would exist in a space with bronze sculptures that I've made. So the bronze then is this kind of precious material, but I take casts from these kind of crudely carved styrofoam figures. So they're kind of, it's kind of playing with that idea of value, where the styrofoam was just really quickly carved with a craft knife, and then I would spend months taking casts and recasting and casting and casting and casting until I got it right. And that's just another way of kind of putting contradictions back into my work. I also make these huge prints behind me, so they're about 6 meters in length, and they're of columns from the British Museum. So again, that's another nod to the British Museum and to this idea of museums and how they give us information. And I suppose there's not really much more to say about it other than the whole idea behind it is this idea that we live in this kind of post-truth world where objective facts are less important than appeals to emotion and personal belief, kind of fake news stuff. But what happens is these mechanisms of power behind these emotional appeals is obscured. And the whole idea of my work is to try and make people look at an object and see the mechanisms in its making and maybe rethink how they view these objects when they do see them in a museum. Maybe think about the history of them a little bit more. That might be a bit pretentious of me, but that's what I'm trying to do. So I suppose, in conclusion, through a process of manipulation and reappropriation, I'm trying to undermine that historical and emotional connection that we have to the pristine white marble statue or column or bit of architecture, to try and undermine those 18th century aesthetics that we've all kind of been raised with and that we're still experiencing. And I try to do it in a kind of a playful but pointed way with these little assemblages. And it's kind of a way of exploring the cultural influences and the implications of them in a hegemonic society like the one we live in. And I don't know what else to say, so I'm going to leave it at that. And I'm just going to say thank you so much for listening to me. And I hope you enjoyed it. And thanks so much for going online today and watching all this. It's a tough time, and it's great that we can still share our work with the world. And thanks so much to the Bloomer guys.
If you're an artist, when you contribute just €1 a month to support Bloomers, you get access to a number of features designed to help you if you're in the early stage of your career. These brand new features are put in place to assist with your professional development and provide support. As an official patron of Bloomers, you'd help us to do what we're doing in an even more substantial way. You'd get all of the benefits of Tier 1 and also a subscription to Bloomers magazine. So if you're interested in contributing to Bloomers, see the link in the description below and that will bring you to our Patreon and you'll be able to see all of the tiers and loads more information. Thanks very much.
Hello and welcome to the Bloomers Issue 5 launch. I'm Emily, the agony ant now. That's what we're doing. We're doing an agony ant thing now, that's right. With my hat. I can't help people if I don't have this hat on. I'm not going to make that a thing, actually, no, because I'm just not going to want to wear this hat every single time. So I have my questions here to answer to help you with your problems, of which there are many, and I'm here to help. I'm here to tell you what to do. I'm here to tell you what to do. First question. It's on red paper. Where are the best places to go discover and find new young writers? It's a very good question. I would say the best place, personally, in my experience, would be definitely, I know this probably sounds like a total cop-out, but it's definitely Twitter, because it's like, when I started going on Twitter for specific literary marketing reasons, I'm talking about specifically in Ireland, Irish publishers and writers are really good community-wise, so that they'll always like, share each other's publications, anything that's coming up, events, well, maybe not because of COVID now, but that sort of thing. So, and especially if you just like start, yeah, if you start building up that community, just follow people on Twitter, they'll probably follow you back, start reading new writers, and you'll just, it kind of comes naturally, like you just like end up getting recommendations for new young writers, and also just listen to your friends as well, because that kind of tends to be where I get most of my recommendations is, yeah, Twitter or just my friends in general being like, this book's really good, you should read it. And then I do. And then I'm like, shit, my friends have really good taste. So yeah. Oh, and my worst advice would be open mic nights. No, I'm joking. Go to those, they're great. This is the next question. How do I fill the void inside me? A very complicated question. My worst advice would be, and this is not from personal experience, my worst advice would be to sleep with someone who doesn't actually like you at all. And then possibly take some drugs, maybe just like the morning after pill, something like that, something. And then spend all of your tax back that you got from your retail job on Tuborg every day for like 3 months. That's my worst advice. My best advice would be to just completely immerse yourself in something that you want to do or have wanted to do for a long time. Like, just read a lot, have the fucking laugh. Have the laugh with your friends, possibly with some Tuborg. Not as much as I said in the worst advice though. Maybe a Guinness. Go to a bunch of grapes, have a pint of Guinness. Lovely. Maybe learn an instrument, learn the guitar. Yeah, learn the guitar, fill up the void. Easy. Surround yourself with art. Not saying that that's the best advice I could give, but personally that's worked for me in the past. Filling the old void. Big old howl inside of me. Thank you so much for writing in. Okay, the next question we have is, what would be a better online series to start during lockdown? Breaking Bad or Sopranos? Now, this is a question that's very close to home. My worst advice would be to watch Breaking Bad and really concentrate on everything you're seeing. You know, root for the best character, the best and goodest character, which is obviously Walter White. My best advice would be to definitely do both. I would watch Breaking Bad probably while doing something else because it's really good to have on because it's like, oh god, and it's fine. It's a grand show, it's exciting. Apologies to all of the Breaking Bad stans. Is that a thing? Do people stan Breaking Bad now? I don't know, people probably don't anymore. My parents maybe. And then also watch The Sopranos because it's really fun to see actually how people compare Breaking Bad and Sopranos so much, even though The Sopranos in terms of character development and depth is a lot more gooder. Thank you for asking that question. I hope I answered it gooder. What are some of the better online sites to make a zine? That's another good question. Thank you so much for asking that question. My worst advice would be to don't ever make a zine. To be honest, I actually don't use that many websites to create zines. I tend to just do them like physically, like on paper, you know, with one page like this, or you know, my giant stapler that's on my cupboard there. Or like, I've been using InDesign a lot more now because I get a free subscription before with my university for making a book. It's ropes, check it out. But if you don't have InDesign, which is probable because it's really expensive, I would also use Electric Zine Maker which is an app by Natalie Lawhead, which is super cool because it makes it so much easier to do it online. And it's free, and you can do loads. You can make it look really like, you know, those old school kind of zines. They're really cool. But mostly, I'm actually just a big fan of just making them yourself with paper, pen and paper, and like magazines and stuff. Can't really beat it. Or a typewriter, if you have access to a typewriter. I do not. I think it looks really cool, aesthetically. Okay, here is the next question. Going on a state-sanctioned, socially distanced first date. Walk on Monday. How do I make it not awkward and awful? Please help. Well, writer, my worst advice would be to give them a great big kiss and hold their hand. Maybe just like a little. My best advice would be like how to make it not awkward. Oh, that's so hard because it's like first dates are the worst. Like you just can't win. I think my main advice would be it's going to be awkward no matter what because someone's going to talk too much because they have no idea what else to do. Someone's going to think that they are talking too much. I am always the person who is talking too much. In my personal experience, the best way to not make it awkward, if it's like you can tell there's like some sort of chemistry there anyway, gauge common ground obviously, see if you both like... I'm so bad at dates, like mine's like, oh, do you like Peep Show, and then just talk about Peep Show for half an hour, and then go home and be like, well, we obviously didn't actually like each other because all we did was talk about Peep Show. So that's not my advice, it's bad. Yeah, just find some common ground, see what they like, see if they laugh at your jokes, see if they're creepy, and if they have no red flags, maybe ask about it on a second date. Maybe another socially distanced walk. No touching. Well, I hope you enjoyed. I hope you enjoyed this Agony Aunt feature that we decided to sprinkle within the launch of issue 5 of Bloomers, where we once lived, where myths collided, by the issue. Please keep asking us questions, because this will be, as I've said, in the quarterly newsletter that we're going to start putting out. You can find our Patreon, where we have different tiers. Enid probably has talked about this already. Also buy Ropes, which I'm publishing. That'll be cool if you bought Bloomers and Ropes. Thank you. Bada bing, bada boom. Okay. As Tony Soprano would say, what are you gonna do? Christopher, you fucking... Christopher. Hey! Gabagool!
To end our launch, here is a lovely performance by Maija Sofia. Thanks so much. Bye-bye. Stay safe.
Hello. Thank you for tuning in to the lovely launch of issue 5 of Bloomers. My name is Maija Sofia, and I'm going to play a few songs for you. And this one is called Smile Please.
Smile, please. Smile.
Sorry for the slightly strange camera angle. The laptop I'm using has a camera like down at the bottom, and if I tilt it, all you can see is the keyboard. So yeah, I'm gonna mostly play some new songs, I think, because I'm getting bored in lockdown and trying to write new songs. But this is an older song and it's called The Glitter. Bed getting slice pins and needles. So I want to say thank you to Enid and Kim for getting me involved and asking me to play, and also asking me to write something in response to, let me just get the picture, this really beautiful work by Gemma Carney. I found it really evocative, and the piece that I wrote in response is kind of about like relics and loss and like imbuing inanimate things with like a meaning outside of themselves, and that's like a real Catholic thing. Well, a real religious thing in general, but I've coincidentally, perhaps recently, been like really interested in reading about the lives of saints, and I'm going to play a song now about Saint Sebastian. I've turned my bed, you can't really see, but this is my bed, into my performance corner, so just have to bear with me slightly. That's loud enough. Okay, so this song is called Saint Sebastian. Just realised that Saint Sebastian is, as well as a number of other things like being the original gay icon, is the patron saint of plague, which I forgot about, but here we are. I actually wrote that song before our current plague circumstances, but anyway, okay, what song am I doing next? Okay. I'm going to stick with the religious theme because, Jesus Christ, because why not? And this is another older song from my album, and it's called Hail Mary. Baby, I'm still fine.
to kiss with your mouth wide open. Learn to kiss like there's still hope and hope. And hope and hold me close. And I'm aware that just a piece of flesh, just a paradise, no thoughts, no worthwhile. Catch on fire, could you let me know if you set me alight? Can I burn out slow? Hail Mary, full of grace, get into the back seat and wipe the dirt from your face. Learn to kiss with your mouth wide open. Learn to kiss like there's still hope and hope.
Okay, I'm gonna do another new song. Actually, one that's really new that I only wrote a few days ago. I don't know, could have been a few weeks ago. I've completely lost track of any sense of lateral time. Doesn't have a name yet. Is that loud enough? I think so. Doesn't have a name yet. It's just, yes, oops, one place. He is a man that I do not trust. He's lied to disguise his envious lust. He cast an eye affection, he knows I'm easily swayed. He knows that a man to me is just a way to fill the days. He knows that I'm unafraid. He knows that I don't care, that I take the bait.
to love. He knows I still haven't learned to build up his shell or a wall or a crust. He's a man that I do not trust. He knows I'm easily swayed. He knows a man to me is just a way to fill the days. He knows that I'm easy prey. He knows that I don't care, that I throw it away. He sees I've been dreaming. I open my mouth to scream. No sound is released. Screaming this silence since I was a child, and he knows I'm easily swayed. He knows I was looking for a way to fill the days. He knows that I'm easy prey. He knows that I don't.
I've just been writing loads of short little songs on this really shitty keyboard, but it's actually a fun break from guitar because I'm not very good at guitar either. But my friend was throwing out this keyboard last summer because literally nobody wanted it, and I was like, I'll give it a chance. So this is, I'm just gonna do one more song, and I'm gonna have to tune my guitar because I'm just gonna have to do that. Thank you for listening, and thank you again, Enid and Kim, and all of everyone involved in the lovely new issue of Bloomers. And what else was I gonna say? Oh yeah, I'm tuning this. Sorry. Bear with me. So, this song is called The Wife of Michael Cleary, and it's about a real strange historical incident that happened in Tipperary in the 1890s and has become like so embedded in folklore. It's become like a children's nursery rhyme, and there's loads of kind of weird deviations and myth making about what actually happened. But essentially it's about a woman called Bridget Cleary, who was a seamstress in Clonmel, and one day she's doing her own thing, minding her own business, and then one day her husband Michael became convinced that she had been switched with a fairy changeling, and orchestrated a ritual exorcism to try and burn out the fairy and try and summon back the real Bridget Cleary. But funnily enough, after the ritual burning, the real living mortal human Bridget Cleary never returned, and her charred body showed up in a ditch like 4 days later. It's quite grim. But that's what this song's about, and yes, I always feel strange. This is a bit odd finishing my sets with this song, but sure, here we are. Thank you for listening. My name is Maija Sofia.
Mm-hmm. on the beach and underneath my petticoats of cotton and calico. A gypsy heart and a mad woman's soul. So stir your tea leaves and butter your bread, but the wife of Michael Cleary won't be home again. And the sun's glints like cleavers, my love, it was only a fever. I swear I tried to get clean, but keeps the bats away and it keeps the devil in the room. And he would look into my eyes, my two round lapis lazuli. Set me alight and we'd cast the demons out all night, till they doused the flames by the holy well and the smoke filled up the guilty air and the village smelled like burning flesh as the changeling was put to rest. And all the ladies shook their heads, bit their lips as they softly said, the scandal of the mess, the wife of Cleary Mac be dead. And the moon gaped like an open mouth as we stood in shock to watch the flames die down. My be safe now, Liverpool bound, and I'm safe from hell in the hallowed ground. The stars glint like cleavers, my love, it was only I try to get clean, but it keeps the bats away and it keeps the devil near.
Okay, thank you so much for listening. Good night.